name is Mehdi Bennis. I'm a professor at the University of Oulu, head of the ICON group. Today I'll be talking to you about the topic of connected edge intelligence for beyond 5G and 6G. So it all goes back to centralized machine learning, essentially, where you had a bunch of devices which were communicating their raw data. This could be photos, of course, to the cloud, and then the cloud would just carry on training and inference tasks. This obviously violates privacy, but also from a communication perspective is terrible in terms of latency and bandwidth. Turns out in 2017, Google came up with the idea of federated learning, where now, instead of communicating raw data, devices, which could be drones, vehicles, even base stations, would communicate over the air model updates, right? And then the server would actually just average its models and then send them back to the device. This would continue until the model is trained. So this obviously does not violate privacy because you no longer communicate raw data, and it's very good in terms of bandwidth efficiency. And you still use the cloud, but for a different purpose compared to centralized learning. Now, you can also get rid of the server, where you could do the same training task here collaboratively amongst, say, collaborative robots in your factory, where you inherit essentially the scalability of this approach, but also the fact that you're training the model in a totally privacy-preserving manner. Now, this very interesting intersection between machine learning on one hand and wireless communication on the other hand gives rise to a very interesting problem. So now, for instance, the devices need to communicate to learn their model under the constraints of small data. So we are no longer in the big data paradigm. You have now, of course, on-device constraints in terms of memory, storage, and compute, and obviously bandwidth, but also the data is no longer IID. You are no longer in the centralized setting, but the data is non-IID. On the other hand, of course, we have the constraints in terms of communication, so fading, interference, and other spatiotemporal network dynamics. Now, this very interesting co-design between machine learning and communication gives rise to very fundamental problems in terms of how do you train a model in a distributed, communication-efficient, fast, and reliable manner. Now, given a pre-trained model, how do you do collaborative inference over wireless links? And also, in terms of control, how would you learn a model for controlling, for example, your remote plant or object? Now, what I'm going to do, I'm going to walk you through a number of techniques we developed in my group. So the first one is essentially called model parameter exchange. So here, devices communicate their models to the server. This goes under the name of federated learning. The second family of algorithm is called model output, in which now the devices communicate their output of their models instead of their entire model parameters. Came up with this idea of federated distillation that I'm going to present to you very shortly. And another type of AJR technique called split learning, where, as the name suggests, you split a neural network into multiple segments and you carry out the inference jointly between these devices. Okay. Now let's start with federated learning. So this essentially was the very first application of federated learning in the context of ultra-reliable vehicular communication. So the setting is as follows. You have a number of vehicles which want to transmit reliably, say, their traffic message safety to the other cars, in this case, and their reliability and latency constraints. So this constraint is expressed here. This is the probability that your latency or buffer size larger than a given threshold will be lower bounded by another predefined threshold. Now, to learn this distribution, essentially, you can either do it using data, which corresponds to the queue length here. You can either communicate all this data to the server, and then the server will just train the model for you. Or you could do it in a federated learning manner, which we actually did. So now these devices will communicate the model parameters here to the server, and then the server will just average them and then send them back. Since we are in an ultra-reliable setting, we're interested in characterizing this blue part of the distribution of the latency here, again, using data. So you can, of course, formulate this mathematically. Here, I'm just showing you here, essentially, the maximum likelihood formulation, where you essentially need to learn from data and across many vehicles the scale and shape parameter, right? So now let's look at the results. Here, what we plot the exchange data, right, between the vehicles versus the number of vehicles and the reliability measure here. Because essentially, we wanted to show what's the performance lost if you compare to the centralized setting. Turns out, essentially, that we not only guarantee the same reliability comparing with the centralized setting, but also we communicate much less data. Because again, we are communicating models, not the raw data. Now, why not essentially try to look also at the scenarios where you no longer need a server. For example, you can have a device which is very far from its base station. There is no need for him to transmit these models. So we need to look at scenarios, what we refer to as serverless or fully distributed setting. So now what we have, we again formulate our optimization problem, which is about training a model across multiple workers. We divide this collection of workers or devices into two groups. You could do it, of course, more than two groups, where you have the head group in purple, the tail group in yellow. So now what you do, you have this worker H3, which is going to be communicating with these two neighbors, T2 and T4. So say at iteration K plus one, it will communicate its model, right? And then T2 and T4 will update the model. And then likewise, T4 would communicate with its two immediate neighbors. And then you also update your dual variable locally. So this is a completely decentralized setting without the need of a server. If you apply this technique, for example, in a linear regression task, so here what we're comparing it with is the number of baselines. So you have the gradient descent, you have another NeurIPS baseline back 2 years ago, lazily aggregated gradient descent, and our approach here called JDMM for group ADMM. So you can see essentially here that the performance is significantly better than the baseline in terms of communicating, converging much, much faster, so much lesser number of iterations. You can also see it through another metric, which is the cumulative communication cost. Again, much, much better performance compared to descent or other baselines. A natural extension in this type of work is to essentially look at model quantization. Namely, the question is, can I actually reduce the precision of my model, say, from 32 bits to, say, 1 bit or 2 bit, and not take a hit on the accuracy? So that's essentially what we did in a follow-up work. And we essentially show here the result. This is the loss, the number of total number of transmitted bits for, again, gradient descent baseline. And this is a precision baseline, GADMM, and it's 2-bit quantized version. So you can see essentially that we get significant gains in terms of transmitting less number of bits. Now moving on to another technique referred to as federated distillation. So this is a different type of algorithm compared to federated learning. Here, essentially, you no longer communicate your entire model parameters. You communicate the logit or the model output. So for those who don't know what the logit is, take an image, push it through a CNN. Typically, you're interested in whether there's a cat or a dog in an image. But essentially, this is a very low information signal. So why not use a richer information signal, which is essentially referred to as logit? So this gives you more information about whether there is 20% dogness or 80% catness in the image. This is the same principle we use. So now the devices will communicate these logits in the uplink to the server. Server will aggregate all these logits, which kind of serve as an experience, as a teacher, to essentially distill this knowledge to another student device, which is trying to actually mimic the performance of the teacher, right? So mathematically, this is also very nicely written here. This is the weight update of your data of your weight of the model, right? Taking into account the learning rate, this is the gradient of the loss. And this term here, which is a novel term, essentially capturing the difference between the prediction made by the teacher and the prediction made by the student, and using this as a structured regularizer to guide the student in learning its model. Now looking at the results, so here we compare federated learning and federated distillation in terms of communication cost. So you can see essentially a huge gains in terms of communication savings here when you use federated distillation. There is a small hit in performance here. For example, if you look at test accuracy, so from 92 to say 85%, but you can actually bridge this gap, which is something we did in follow-up. I'm gonna now also move to another third family of AJR techniques referred to as split learning, right? So here the idea is that you have, for example, a base station which is equipped with a camera, and then you want that this base station predicts in advance whether there is a blockage, right? And then perhaps to hand over the user to a different base station or to take another proactive action. So what we did, we combined essentially two modalities, right? There is a RF modality, which is available at the base station. This is the RF signals, and a bunch of images or their compressed version acquired from the camera, and then feeding these two modalities to convolutional LSTM to again train a model and predict the received power. And to validate this idea, you can look at the left-hand side. Here we have this test performance in terms of root mean square error as a function of the communication cost for inference time. Take into account two baselines. So the first baseline is when you only predict the received power using RF signals. We know that's not a good enough solution. And when you need to use images. So here, for example, the purple curve is when you use 1-bit information, which is essentially interesting because it captures the fact that maybe you are sensitive to privacy. So you just get some sort of 1-bit feedback that you add to your RF signal, and train a model. If you're not concerned really with privacy, then the 4x4 here point essentially is very good in terms of trade-off between communication and test accuracy. Now, what I presented to you so far essentially will continue score. So there are a lot of works here, and even industry now is implementing this in standardization. But I think there is something even bigger coming down the road. So I'm going to be briefly presenting to you what we are currently doing within this new vision called Vision X, which we believe is sitting at the intersection of two revolutions. So the first revolution is machine learning, obviously, but here we need to realize a little bit the current limitations. So despite the hype, current machine learning are essentially just curve fitting. They just, you know, interpolate and learn correlations from data. They're essentially parrots, right? They lack the cognitive abilities of human reasoning, planning, and so on and so forth. So we decided essentially to enlarge and build new type of models which are essentially incorporating notions of invariance, notions of disentanglement, of causality, because these are essentially missing today in current models, which are just simple statistical models, right? And with this, you can learn new models or semantic representations satisfying this six desiderata for a given task. This task could be training, inference, reason, any type of task that you want. The other revolution, obviously, is funding communication. So here is a very nice research area referred to as Paul Shannon or semantic communication. So this goes back to 1948. The famous paper of Shannon is essentially laid out three levels of information. You had level A, level B, level C. Level A essentially is the one where you just communicate X and try to reproduce exactly the same message at the receiver. Right, so this is a reconstruction task, basically. Turns out that Shannon himself got rid of a lot of structure, meaning, context. Just take X and give me X hat, which equals to X. Right? Now, although Shannon himself warned us against using this type of information, because this is not information that biological systems use, there are two levels, level B and level C, which is about extracting meaning from data, and that's what you communicate to the receiver. The receiver understands the meaning of your message and then try to carry out a task, right? So this is essentially what we are now working on under the umbrella of semantic communication, which is essentially boiling down to how agents can really model and reason over other agents in the environments, intents, goals, and beliefs via interaction, right? So now information is no longer a scalar, as was the case in level A, but essentially is living inside a what we call information space. So it has certain topology and shapes, which we are trying to now characterize. So this is the Vision X again, which is about semantic communication and machine learning. So from a machine learning perspective, again, we want really to stop learning models in the data space. We need to learn now the semantic representations of the real world. So objects, relationships, agency. So we came up with this system one versus system two idea here, essentially to disentangle a little bit the current works done in the literature, which are still very much statistical approaches towards the more difficult one referred to as system two semantic communication, which requires different mathematics, including, you know, group theory, category theory, algebra, topology, and so on and so forth. From a communication perspective, as I already said, you need to move away from just reconstructing the same message at the receiver towards now reasoning, using logic to, you know, infer what the sender is trying to communicate to the receiver and act upon it to solve a task, for example, collaborative robots factory, right, or human-machine collaboration. With this, we can actually learn model with less data, right, more reliably. We are essentially more sustainable, right, and we are truly intelligent, because this is essentially what 6G promised to do. So with that, thank you very much.